In offering the idea of a coast-to-coast walk, I am not contradicting myself at all. There's nothing official about it. It's an example of what might be done without any opening speeches and fanfares. I describe the route I planned and walked, and for any who care to tread in my footsteps, directions are given. It's a good expedition, although I say it myself.
The second week of our coast-to-coast walk brought a complete contrast to our journey through Lakeland. But as Wainwright said on more than one occasion, none the worse for that. It was a journey over the Pennine watershed, across the very backbone of England, a journey which Wainwright had meticulously recorded more than 15 years ago. In the 35 miles that lead to Keld, we'd walk through 2,000 years of history. We were to meet that morning under the solitary tower of Shap Abbey.
Now, that's been there since 1199. And it was occupied by an order of monks until the 16th century, when it had to be surrendered to Henry VIII. It was abandoned, fell into disrepair. Many of the stones were taken away for the farms. And it remained in a state of decay until about 50 years ago, when it was taken over by the Ministry of Works, who've looked after it ever since.
It says on the signboard as you come in that it was an order of monks from France that built it. I mean, it must have been quite a shock to the system, coming from rural France the bleak expanses of Shap.
Yeah.
That would test the religious dedication a bit.
Was, of course, quite extensive. But everything gradually vanished except the tower.
Oh.
That's remained. That's the only original part you can still see. But it's wonderfully situated, isn't it?
Yeah, beautiful.
Because the old monasteries were always built near a river, the source of water. The river is the Lowther, ultimately joining the Eden. This is Oddendale, a hidden little hamlet right off the tourist track that nobody ever visits, or used not to. I notice now they're doing bed and breakfast.
Yes, I'm just looking at what you said about it when you originally came here. In your guide you say, do not disturb the sequestered privacy of the hamlet of Oddendale. Keep outside its walls and turn right.
Yeah.
You're probably not going to go down into the hamlet yourself.
No, I don't want to go down. You are going, are you?
Do you mind if I pop down and have a look at it?
Okay, right.
You can have a pipe full while while I'm down in the hamlet. It's a lovely little spot. I'll leave you with the three nuns. I'll see you in a minute or two.
Okay.
The map of England is an oyster very rich in pearls. Plan your own marathon and do something never done before, something you will enjoy, a route that'll take you to places often read about but never yet seen. Preferably go alone, for it is the solitary walker always who most closely identifies himself with his surroundings, who observes as he goes along, who really feels the satisfaction of achievement. If you must have a friend, choose one who is quiet.
Well, I think I may be a word or two away from AW's image of that perfect companion. But if I'm not always silent, at least I can be a willing listener, as Wainwright, with ease, captures a landscape or a sense of history in a few bluff northern words.
This is the Oddendale stone circle. This has been here for thousands of years before BC. It's the only one I've seen of this nature. You've got the outer ring of stones, still very clearly shown, but in the middle is another smaller circle. I haven't sufficient knowledge to say what the origin of these stone circles was, but it's marked on the ordnance maps. That's the way I picked it up.
Very hard to spot, though. I mean, you could walk past it very easily, couldn't you?
You could, yes.
And I suppose this is the difference in this next piece of the walk, that we've come out of the Lake District where all the beauties are so obvious, and you can't avoid them.
No.
Here we're going to have to look a bit harder.
Yes, yes.
But will we find beautiful things still?
Oh, yes, many. Although the landscape looks completely barren, no habitations in sight anywhere for miles. On the way, there are charming villages, completely unspoilt. And a little further on is a pile of stones called Robin Hood's Grave on the ordnance maps. He seems to have died all over the north of England, like Rob Roy in Scotland. His graves are all over the place. Away to the west there, you get the long skyline of the Lakeland Fells. You can barely see them today. And this is really the last place we'll ever see the Lake District until you get onto the highest Pennines. Then you can look back and see them again. And here we're in the middle of the wildest part of Westmorland. There isn't a habitation in sight. No cars. Left civilization behind. Compare this place with Blackpool.
Oh, this is the real Golden Mile, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, when we were down in Patterdale,
seeing the coach parties arriving at the hotel in Patterdale, it must be a prison sentence, being crammed into one of those coaches and hauled off around the Lake District.
No escape from your companions. Now,
the route detailed in this book is my own preference, but some walkers may choose to vary it in places, either to make additional detours or to shortcut corners, or even follow their own course over lengthy distances. Such personal initiatives are to be encouraged if they do not involve trespass. The way you go and the time it takes matter not. The essence of the walk is the crossing of England from one coast to the other on foot.
Now left Newbiggin, which is near the source of the River Loon, we're approaching the hidden valley of Smardale, which very few people know about. And I've invited Tom Clare to come along. He's the county archaeologist, and he'll explain things to us.
This is obviously a very... It's rare, almost unheard of, for Wainwright to welcome any company on our walks. But Tom Clare proved the exception to that self-imposed rule. He could reveal the treasures hidden beneath this landscape, where foot by foot and yard by yard lie the bare bones of our past. In Tom's company, we discovered that even a stone wall has its own peculiar history.
We know exactly when it was built. It was built in 1560 by Thomas Lord Wharton, who lived near Kirby Stephen, and it enclosed 560 acres. It was built as a deer park wall to keep deer in. And if you look at it very closely, it differs from most other dry stone walls around here by its thickness. It's an enormous structure, and if you think of the length of it, it's really a testament to, I suppose, the power that a local landowner could have at that time.
The road. There's history about this road, isn't there?
Yes. Looking at it today, you would hardly recognise it as the main road that formerly ran between Kirby Stephen and Kendal. And its very deep shape that we see today is really the result of traffic constantly coming up the hill, wearing it away, and the road surface was lowered and lowered until it hit bedrock and could go no further.
This is very much an example, isn't it, A.W., of what you've been telling us ever since we left the Lake District, that on this part of the walk, there are a lot of very interesting things, but you have to look hard to find them.
Exactly, yeah. And you have to have a bit of knowledge about them, and that's why we've asked Mr. Clare, because I'm not qualified to explain them, but Tom will. We're now on Scandal Bridge. Still on the old road from Kendal to Kirby Stephen, at the entrance to the Valley of Smardale. Now, from here, there are several antiquities in view, aren't they? Even before we get to them. Can you tell us something about the bridge itself and the giant's graves over there?
Well, the bridge itself is really part of the old road network.
Yeah.
It sometimes describes the packhorse bridge, but you'll see that it's too wide for what certain people in the Lake District would recognise as a packhorse bridge. It's wide enough to take a coach, and quite clearly is part of the old main road. The antiquities belong to various periods of farming. The giant's graves, for example, on the hillside, amongst the trees, they're certainly not burial mounds in the traditional sense of the word. The best idea is that they are, in fact, coney beds, or rabbit warrens, introduced after the Norman Conquest, when food in winter, fresh meat, was always in short supply, and rabbits were introduced and cultivated, if that's the right word, for their fresh meat. And the coney beds were deliberately built as places where the rabbits could live protected and be taken out and used as a larder, in effect.
The site we're looking across to here, this is Severals, is it?
That's right. The interesting thing about Severals is that you can actually walk from what were quite clearly the original stockyards, up a lane, through the arable fields, the former arable fields, onto what was quite clearly in Roman times, or whenever the settlement was in use, was unenclosed common land. And so you're actually seeing a system of agriculture which hasn't really changed that much in 2,000 years. Mm-hmm. When seen from the air, it's quite evident that there was both arable and pasture farming going on.
Well, can you put a date on them?
I would say that Severals is Roman in date, running through up to and just before the coming of the Vikings.
When you first came through here, A.W., did you realise that the settlement existed at Severals?
Oh, yes. Yes, it's shown on the ordnance map. Oh, yes, I had a good look round there. And the giant's graves. And then followed the old road over into Kirby Stephen. Well, apart from the building of the railway, I think this place has never been disturbed. There are no habitations apart from railway cottages.
What's the railway line like now, Edward? Because you've walked it.
It's become a garden of flowers, the old railway line. You get some specimens of plants there that are quite rare. The great patches of rose root, bloody crane's bill, orchids, primroses. It's a delight to walk now, isn't it?
Yes.
And a great attraction to botanists nowadays. But the track's been pulled up, of course.
Do you remember that railway line when it was working?
Just remember. It was a junction at Tebe from the main Scottish line and cut across here to Kirby Stephen, crossing on the way the Settle to Carlisle line. Then it crossed Stainmore and Barnet Castle and Darlington. What a tourist attraction it will be today.
It's a testament to Wainwright's skill as a cartographer that the coast-to-coast walk passes through only two towns on its journey from one coast to the other. After Smardale Bridge, you travel northeastwards, past Limekiln Hill and across the Settle to Carlisle Railway, to arrive in the market town of Kirby Stephen.
It seems strange being back in civilization again.
I like Kirby Stephen. Big marketplace here where there used to be a cattle market, I think.
Did there? And the map?
Where is it?
It's up here.
There?
Yeah.
It used to be at ground level.
Oh, it's been put up on the wall now.
Wainwright, isn't it?
Yeah.
I've read your books and I've walked the fells.
Have you?
Alas, I can't anymore. But I certainly enjoyed some of the things that you've seen. Mm. Mr. Wainwright. Ah.
So you're living on your memories of the fells now?
Oh, well, I've got a few hundred slides. I can sit and watch, look at those.
Yeah. I still go.
My wife still goes.
Yes.
It's,
we just part way through the coast to coast.
Are you?
Oh, I love it.
Enjoying it?
Filming it with the BBC.
You're filming it with the BBC.
Yeah. Oh,
we could have we could have had better weather for the venture, but
yeah.
Oh yes, but you don't want it too hot, do you?
No. It'd be nice to see more than 100 yards, though.
Yes.
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 True.
Nice
I
to
like
meet you. Nice clear.
Right.
Thanks a lot.
Enjoy the rest. Of it.
Thanks a lot. I think we'll have to get back to the quiet of the hills again,
AW. Busy, isn't it?
There had to be some reason you were dragging me down Kirby Stephen High Street.
You see what it says? Coast to coast chip shop. You never miss an opportunity to pass a chip shop.
Well, good afternoon, dear.
Good afternoon. How are you?
All right.
Hungry, I hope.
Right.
He couldn't resist the coast-to-coast fish and chips.
Is that so? Good, good. Well,
fish and chips have been my staple diet for 80 years.
Is that so? Grand. I do believe you used to come past the shop once or twice. I've seen you pass
it. Oh, I knew it was here, yes.
How do you realise this was Mr. Wainwright?
Yes, I have, because I've been a fan of AW's for quite a long while. I have all his books, all the guidebooks. When they were cost, I think they cost about 12 and 6 each when I bought them.
Right, you did.
I don't know what they are now. Well, you don't buy another
£6
one.
£6 or something.
Yes, works of art, those are.
Well, before he tells me off, I think we better order some fish and chips, haven't we? It's all very well standing here chatting on.
Well, I've got some ready. Are you going to eat them straight away? Would you like them open?
You want them open or you eat them in the dining room? In the dining room. Fish and chips twice, please. Certainly. If you like
to go through them.
Thanks very much.
I'll see
you to you. You seem to be smiling, AW.
Yeah.
Great. You want some vinegar?
Yeah.
There you go. I have trouble getting you away from here. The chips do.
Right. Start then.
Kirkby Stephen is an obvious staging post on the walk. A place for licking wounds and replenishing supplies. It is the market town for a wide rural area, and therefore is a busy little place. Yet it is away from main tourist routes and remains unspoiled.
Among the staging posts on our 190-mile journey, there's none more prominent than the eerie landmark of Nine Standards on the shoulder of the Pennines. Whether these stones were really raised to fool encroaching Scottish invaders into thinking the English were camped here matters not at all. We'd had our last view of Lakeland. Now the rivers all run east, and for the next 20 miles, we'll be in the company of two majestic Pennine dales.
Well, this is a very remote farming community, and although we're in one of the Yorkshire dales here, it's one of the dales that people never come to. The other Yorkshire dales are very well known and often visited, even by people from the south. But here, no visitors at all.
And what is one called?
This is Whitsundale. This is the beck draining the moors to the east of the Nine Standards and goes down to join the swale. There's some nice little waterfalls and cascades further down before it joins the swale. Must be a lonely life here. Well, we're coming down from Ravenseat now and making acquaintance with the river Swale. And the Swale will be our companion for the next 50 miles to Richmond and beyond. Beautiful river, beautiful valley. You can see the valley stretching away down there.
So on this stretch of the route, where would you recommend people stayed?
At Keld.
And that's how far down? How far do we have to go down to there?
3 or 4 miles. And Keld is the halfway point of the walk.
It's Swaledale, your favourite dale?
I think it is, yes. I think Swaledale is delightful. Not the best known of the dales, but I like Swaledale. Keld is a Norse name meaning a spring or a place of water, and it lives up to its reputation. There are wonderful waterfalls at Keld. Beautiful place. Never seems to change. It's exactly today as it was when I first came 60 years ago. In the middle of the street, you see a sundial on the wall which records the hours. But time here is measured in centuries.
Wainwright's love of this upland community goes back over half a century, to the days before the mass of tourists came. But today's walkers, looking for a night's shelter after crossing the Pennines, need to plan carefully, for bed space is still strictly limited. Those not using the youth hostel usually end up at East Stonedale Farm and meet Doreen Whitehead, someone rapidly becoming a coast-to-coast legend herself.
And Mrs. Whitehead done a remarkable thing. She's published an accommodation guide to the coast-to-coast walk with all the names of the places that provide bed and breakfast along the route. How did you manage to get all those names, Mrs. Whitehead?
By asking the visitors when they came to stay with me where they'd stayed at St. Bees or Robin Hood's Bay and making a list of them. And then I decided to put it into a little book and to sell it, you know, and it's been very, very popular.
It's
I'm very, very pleased.
Very useful book. I mean, it's indispensable, isn't it?
Well, I hope so. Living where we live, away from the village, it's not a very good road to the farm, and so I try not to take people with cars because there's 4 gates to open. And you can imagine them coming along from a town in their high-heeled shoes and having to open gates. They don't like it very much. Mm. I tell them we're only a farm, we're not a first-class hotel, so if the cat runs around, you know, they haven't to bother about it.
Have you had any Americans?
A lot, yes.
Have you?
Yes, it's getting quite popular with the Americans. Apparently, somebody had walked it last year and have written a piece in a book over in America, and they're...
Oh, they wrote to me. There's a man and wife and the four grown-up children, did they come here?
No, they didn't, because I remember about them, though. They wrote to me and wanted to come and stay last year, and it was in September. And I was busy with the sheep sales. Of course, doesn't seem to take as much out of them as the Pennine Widows. You know, somehow or other, they enjoy it. They don't enjoy some of the long stages that you did.
Don't they?
No, some of them break them in half. They think it's a bit much from Rosthwaite to Patterdale. They maybe not as fit as you were when you walked it.
Where does your route arrive here?
Well, now, for about 100 yards, the Pennine Way and the Coast to Coast coincide. Coming out of the village, they cross the footbridge over the swale, come up here. You go into the Pennine Way, you head north. Coast to Coast follows the valley down.
Obviously, people use this as a place to leave notes for each other. There's one been stuck to the sign.
Yes.
And what's this set of waterfalls here?
This is East Gale Force. It's down there. This is the sound you get all day in Keld, water, rushing water, all day long.
The little cluster of stone buildings at Keld, tidily yet haphazardly arranged along its only street, is attractively situated on a headland overlooking the swale. Little has changed here for generations. Time is measured in centuries at Keld. The joy of Keld is the swale, a swift-flowing torrent sheltered by white cliffs of limestone fringed with trees. Always at Keld, there is the music of the river.